It's 10 o'clock's arrived. We've got a quorum thanks to Penatoe. We will have people dropping in and out on council business, so there is a risk that someone has to go a wee bit earlier or arrives a wee bit later. We may need to take a short break, but in theory, we should remain quorum across the meeting. So perhaps if I can ask Mayor Milko to do an opening karakia, that would be really appreciated.
Koho atao ue nuku o koro ngara ara matu nahi kahakato umarae.
And that is the beginning of the lunar phase, moving into ohoata. Ohoata is my phase today, and it is the start of high energy phases following the new moon. So hopefully we've got some high energy for our hui today, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Apology, we have an apology from Councillor McNally, who is involved in hearings today. I've got an apology for lateness from Councillor Court. She will join us somewhere about 11 or 11.30. She's currently hearing another council-related matter. And we've got an apology from Kofi Kelly and Councillor Panatuhi. That's they have to depart off on other council business. Although I missed that. It's a long way in the distance, that screen, and see whose names are up there. So we've got Pinatoe. So we're still chorus. So if we can perhaps accept those apologies and provide those members with leave of absence today. Do I have a mover?
Yeah.
John and okay, thank you. All those in favour?
Aye.
Carried. We've got no deputations. Chairperson announcements. I guess just I've mentioned about quorum. I propose also, because we've got our Far North Holdings people, to move item 5.2 forward to the opening item after confirmation of the previous minutes, just so that you can get away. Andy and Lisa, that's brilliant. There's a couple of items sort of that haven't, in the matters arising, that haven't come up here naturally in the papers, and I might just mention that from the annual report process, Deloitte's have come back to us, and as they noted, that had some extra issues at the last meeting in the consolidation phase and bringing all the consolidated accounts together and some of the entries. They've come back to myself and Charlie with some initial suggestions yesterday of their overrun costs. They said they incurred about $40,000 and looking to recover about $27,000. We haven't had a chance to have a good look at that yet, and I'm suggesting that if the committee is happy for Charlie and myself perhaps just to deal with that rather than waiting till February when our next meeting is. Has anyone got any objections to that process? In which case, I don't think it probably is more operational, probably doesn't need a minute, but I'll take guidance.
We can have a note.
Just adding a note that the committee was happy for.
Unanimous.
Charlie and myself to do that. And also, look, coming from that, there is a project that Charlie's coordinating to look at the consolidation process and working with Far North and the other various entities that we bring in to try and see if we can streamline that a little and get it through and tie it in also with another project that the council has to move from the on-site tech one product to the cloud version. of the product. So whether there's any advantages in thinking about that with all the various parties over time. So it's going to be sort of a 6 to 12 month project. So I think the massive thing is to get the council up there and then perhaps talk to everyone else to see whether there's any sense in doing that. Recently, I have seen in other councils I'm involved in tax issues being looked at. So I've suggested through to Charlie that maybe we want to put that onto the do list across, because we're still subject to taxes of various kinds, just to make sure that the systems are robust. I've seen where there's been a few little slips and areas that have been found. I guess one that's come across my calendar in the last few days was the Whangarei. The decisions that they made on fluoridation. And we, of course, are in the process down this route. And I think a change in process, from my own point of view, this committee would need to be very aware of the risks if there was any changes in the current status of where we're going and consider what the implications are quite carefully before any, if there was to be a change in direction in that area. But we can perhaps deal with that a little more in the public exclusion, because I think we may have a comment somewhere sitting in the papers in that area of where our progress is. Project risks, I think, are significant in all councils that I'm on. So just throwing that into the agenda. For us to be thinking about roading and water in particular. These particular papers are silent on those projects, and I'm just wondering whether, without cutting across your infrastructure committee, they're but looking solely at getting signalling if there's any risks of underperformance, budgetary issues or anything coming out on these major projects might be useful. And many of the other councils I'm on are doing the same thing, because they're all facing large investments coming in. There's plenty of chance of things going off the rails, but this committee won't be reperforming the work of another committee. It's really just focusing on, do we have some risks, and are we satisfied that the committees and the council are reducing those risks appropriately? I've raised with Mayor, Chief Executive and Co-Fi possibility of a second independent member, which may, it is a recommendation of the OAG that there are two independents, one chairing and one sitting. But there are opportunities there to perhaps recruit on a skill set. If the council feels of that, move down that direction, that may be useful. It's not a photocopy of my own skill set, perhaps a skill set that has some specialties in other areas where the council is expecting to experience risks over the next 3 years. That may also be useful, you know, for other parts of the council business, maybe an infrastructure-focused person. Given what's going on. And Charlie tells me he's well underway with having a look at the terms of reference and just seeing whether they are still remain. And as a committee, we should be reviewing those every 2 or 3 years anyway, even if we conclude that they're satisfactory. So I think those are sort of my thoughts to leave with you out there. So on that basis there, we'll move to item 4.1.
You there?
Sorry.
You there, Mr. Chairman?
Oh, all right.
Oh, maybe.
Councillor.
Yeah, you made a point earlier on regarding fluoride. I think we need to understand that it is a law by the government that fluoride be present, you know, in public water supply. It has to be present, unfortunately, and we and I looked at the Whangarei District Council. I find it difficult to understand what right they had to make that decision. Because legally we have to follow suit. We have to follow suit. That's the law in regard to fluoride in public water. Thank you.
Yes, I think we've been and discuss this. We've got, I think this may surface and public excluded where it'd be more appropriate because you're heading down a legal matter, and we traditionally, for reasons of privilege, deal with those there. But I'd be more than interested to hear your views at that point where we can perhaps have a full discussion on the legal aspects of the legislation, and that's heading into definitely legal privilege material. So I encourage you to raise that in public excluded, and I'd love to hear your views.
Yeah, I find that very difficult to understand your comment on that, because it is legal. It's out in the public. That fluoride must be presented in water supply. In our water supply.
Yes, I agree with you, and there's been a High Court of Appeal case which has said that the Director General does have the ability to make such directions. So I'm just flagging what I'm seeing in the environment out there since the last meeting of matters that have come up to my attention that we probably should be aware of and be quietly thinking about.
Okay.
And minutes 4.1 on page 12, that commences with the detailed minutes on pages 14 through 18. Does anyone have any matters of factual accuracy in those minutes?
I'm happy to move. Sorry.
John, you're happy to move. Do I have a seconder?
Okay, I wasn't here.
So you weren't there. Do we? I'll second that from the chair.
In the resolution.
In the middle or something.
John, you voted. I'll second it from the chair. Present. Any further discussion before I put the motion? All those in favour?
Right.
Against, if any? Abstentions noted. Carried. Let's move to 5.2 on page 25 of our papers. Charlie, you've got a paper here. If there's any comments you want to make before we perhaps hand it over to our guests, Andy and Lisa.
Just welcome the opportunity for Final Holdings to present the first quarterly financial report for FY25 year. And happy to leave it with you.
I understand you had your AGM yesterday, and that there were three representatives from the council present, and Charlie, our mayor, and our chief executive. So I'll hand it over to you to talk through the presentation that's in the pack.
Okay. Having us again this morning. It was great to have our AGM yesterday, and I think that went well. So welcomed your comments at that time. So, but on to the next year already, the first quarter down, whizzes by. And I was sort of reflecting on this morning before we came over. It's certainly been another busy quarter. So before we get on to the fewer numbers, just to sort of highlight some of the other things that have gone on for us within the quarter. I guess being a finance person, it was great that we were able to deliver an annual report within the specified time frame, 30 September for us, so the 3-month time frame. And so that got approved and published within the time frame, which I think was the first time we've been able to do that for the last couple of years with COVID and auditor issues and what have you. So it was really pleasing to get that back on track and get that done and dusted for the year. It's always nice to move on. You sort of feel like you're thinking about the past for quite some time, don't you, Charlie, doing in your report. So it's nice to move on period on your future. And of course, another key highlight for us was the transition to the local government funding agency. The support of council. So he's going just want to thank you and acknowledge the council for helping us and supporting that transition. That's a really significant step for us and you'll be aware of the, you know, the more favourable funding rates, and so that's quite significant for us. And I'd say the relationship, you know, it's early on in the relationship, but so far it's been, they've been really great to deal with, and so we really have enjoyed working with them. We've also engaged the services of Bancorp Treasury, the same advisors that the council uses to help us, you know, as we go through that global borrowing process to make sure that we're doing reasonable timeframes and helping us with that interest rate risk management. And that's been going really well as well. So looking forward to continuing that. Obviously, the governance review completed by Murray Bain was key for the directors and the board, and I know that they've all found that to be a really constructive process, and we're alongside the board, management is working through some of the action plans coming out of that, which will progress in due course. Operationally, our boatyard won the Boatyard of the Year Award with the New Zealand Marine Operators Association, which was a really great highlight and achievement for our boatyard there. They worked hard over the last few years, so it was really great to be acknowledged by that. And same with the marina, they had their clean marina certification recertified during the period as well. So a good area for us. On the housing side, the Kaukaui development completed in the quarter, so now 60 units up and running in that space, and I think it's been going well. Yeah. And in a similar vein, progressing with the Dargavor construction, which is 46 units, which is
new-ish.
I think I can say that. So, yeah, sorry.
Turn that only orange light green.
Pardon?
That will turn the only orange light in this report green, the completion of Ramfurly.
Yes. Yeah, which is really, yay. Thank you for pointing that out. Yeah. And on the airports, we welcome Barrier Air to the Bay of Islands Airport, which some of you may have enjoyed their service over the quarter. So from our perspective, we've been pleased with how that's going, and looking forward to continuing that relationship. So yeah, so a busy quarter, which is great, and continuing in that vein. So yeah, nicely segue into the SOI targets. So I won't go through those and line by line, but as you pointed out, one orange target, one orange ratio there, which is the consolidated shareholder funds. I think that's just a timing, time we've just dipped under the target 50% at the end of September, and we expect that to lift back up once we've completed Ramfurly and those revaluations are recognised. Obviously, it's early on in the year, so some of the targets, you know, we've only kind of started some work on or the plan to be later in the year, but overall we're pretty comfortable at this point that we're on track to achieve those SOI targets that we've set in place, which is pleasing. On to the numbers themselves. Again, early on in the year, and I've just had my first anniversary with the company itself, so I guess, you know, I don't know if I can claim the newbie place anymore, but just my reflection is, you know, first quarter, it's our quiet quarter, if you like, over that winter period. So, you know, the numbers, it's a light profit for the quarter, but not unexpected at this time of year. So it really highlights that the seasonal nature of our business for me. We're slightly behind budget at the end of quarter one. Not overly concerned about that at this stage, again, because of that time of the year. We're seeing good signs for the rest of the year, the summer, and the construction on the Ramfurly is going well. So we're feeling pretty, at this stage, reasonably confident that we will meet that SOI target. And I think what is pleasing is that compared to this time last year, we are significantly ahead. So the headline number you see in the report doesn't show that, because we had the the gain on sale of the Pohia Maritime Building recognised last year. When we strip that out, we're over 600,000 ahead of this time last year. onto the balance sheet, statement of financial position. There's nothing from my perspective concerning in there to highlight. It's all sort of as we expect, I think. A few different ways on how we're disclosing things now as we work through following the same accounting treatment we had in the financial statements for some of those construction projects. So it makes it look like some of the numbers are looking slightly different, but we're pretty much aligned. And you're starting to see the LGFA borrower notes go in there as the investment as we transition to the longer-term LGFA borrowings. I'm sure you're familiar with that in terms of your own LGFA borrowings as well. We're obviously well within our covenants, which is obviously key to us. And then the last sort of piece in the report was health and safety. No significant issues to highlight there. We're continuing to work through our health and safety plans and improvement program. I think it's progressing well. Carrying on with the same another busy quarter. That's all I wanted to really kind of highlight. And I guess if there's any questions, if there's anything you want to add.
I think you've covered that fairly comprehensive.
Any questions or members?
Yeah, I did have. Well done, by the way. Three real quick questions. Firstly, on health and safety, your continuous improvement program. I like anything that's continuous improvement, so that's a good plus. When is your, because you are reporting to this risk, your risks as well on a regular basis? I know that. Is that due next time? I'm not sure because it's not sure the report. When is this next due?
6 monthly, so I think it will be the next one.
Next month, okay. And there's no real risk that we need to be aware of, I take it, at this time?
No, not at this stage, but it's all the normal risks that have been reported before, and all of those have been generally moved down as we've gone into risks in respect of most of the areas of the business.
Yeah, and I see Barry Air, which is good for us, flying into Kerikeri as well, and of course Kaitaia. How many flights, the flights per day must have increased, I presume, but there's plenty of capacity for increased flights. There's no issues there with that, I think.
Yeah, I mean, when the original apron was extended, we put a double apron parking stand, and that allows us to actually have capacity for up to 600,000 passengers. And right now we're up at around 100,000. So there's plenty of capacity at the airport. Again, potential restrictions of restrictions on ATR's loading capability.
Yeah, that's good. I think a place we actually I've seen is instrument landing. And I think that's the only complaints I've seen, which were in the paper publicly as well. But that's got nothing to do with your operation. It's outside of your powers and control of it. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah. Welcome to the CoFi. I see you've joined us online. Any other questions from any other members? I have one question there, that the ATRs are starting to be talked about as reaching towards the end of their operational life. And I know another airport I've involved in is consideration about runway widths on the basis of potential jet conversion or replacement for the ATRs in due course, where they haven't made any decisions or identified any potentials. But are we in a position that if we needed to increase the runway length, or is there a need to?
In that aspect, it's the Q300, the 50-seater that's being effectively removed by 2030. The ATR will remain in the fleet. That has up to 72 seats on it. Now, the ATR does land at Kerikeri, but it can only land on a reduced takeoff and landing restriction waiting, which reduces the passenger numbers down to by roughly 6 passengers per flight, and the commercial viability on it as a result. The runway needs an extension.
Which means there's still more than a max capacity Q300.
All the time it's not as commercially viable. It makes it less attractive in terms of the fleet as they move down out of the Q300 to the 800. So we need to get it up to a full maiden capacity because that'll make it a lot more commercially viable to maintain the existing connectivity and the number of flights that serve Kerry Kerry and Arnold. We were in the process of applying to CAA for a runway extension. But the current legislation requires any regional airport to have a runway extension of 240 metres safety area, no matter what the airport is. So whether you're Wellington, Timaru, Kerry Kerry, doesn't matter what your aircraft is, everybody's has a 240 requirement, which for us would cost 70, 80 million road double directions. It just doesn't work.
So we have an exemption, but if we want to extend any more, we have to meet the new rules.
So what we've got to CAA, and we're not the only regional airport in this scenario, we've actually said, look, we can extend it 120 metres to either end, 119 to be exact. That in itself will provide extra safety for the ATR already operating from Kerry Kerry. And that will allow it to be a fully loaded aircraft. So we're in the process of submitting that application to CAA for their consideration and direction. So that will allow us then to extend it in due course. Should that be. So that's how we're forward thinking. Where Air New Zealand are moving with their network, yes, they'll bring in hybrid aircraft probably in due course, but the ATR is going to be the fundamental carrier for the region.
Yeah, so it's the Q300s that are on a relatively short leash.
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you for that clarification. Any other questions from members online? Okay. We have a resolution here that the Miromiro Assurance Risk and Finance Committee received the Far North Holdings quarterly report September 24. Do I have a mover?
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Moved and seconded. Any further comment before I put the motion? There being none, all those in favour? Aye. Against, if any? Carried. Thank you. Moving on back to item 5.1. Thank you, Andy and Lisa, for your attendance.
Yes. I just make a comment. This is just unrelated, but from your previous conversation about the project, just so you're aware, we're finding, and this might, in terms of infrastructure work, a lot of the contractors right now are obviously finding to not have sufficient work. So it's a very competitive environment where pricing has significantly reduced the number of areas. And so if you're looking forward project work, this is probably a good time to potentially place in those projects where you'll benefit from lack of availability on the market.
Thank you for those observations. I'm seeing various members of the executive team nodding their head, which is good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back to item 5.1, the insurance renewal update. It's page 20 in the papers. Charlie, you or Angie?
I can speak to this one. Thank you, Mr. Chair. So 5.1 insurance renewal update is an information pack related to the insurance renewal process, which FNDC has just concluded. So we did at our last committee meeting receive an update in the insurance market from Aon. We have since received the final pricing, which is included in the table on page 20. The pricing indicates a increase of close to 10%, $175,000 from the prior year. Primarily, this is driven through material damage and business interruption policies and professional indemnity policies. It's noted that a substantial amount of that increases because of additional assets council's taken off in the last 12 months. So all in all, taking into consideration those assets, the policies relatively static, which is positive, especially by comparison to some of our peer councils around New Zealand who are experiencing significant inflation due to earthquake-prone assets. On conclusion of the exercise, the team has also discussed with Aon opportunities to review our policies going into the review process next year. It's appropriate that we do this periodically to make sure that the insurance that we have is fit for purpose and in line with financial and risk expectations for council. And so a number of the items are discussed on pages 21 and 22 in terms of opportunities to identify cost savings for insurance policies going forward. I will take those tables as read, but staff will be working through these items with Aon over the next 6 to 12 months, so that by the time we come through the renewal process, we will have a number of options to present to elected members for consideration, and including implications such as if there'll be consultation requirements. I'm happy to take questions on it at this point.
Question?
Yes.
Thanks for that, Charlie.
Holy heck.
We spend a lot. Insurance is expensive, eh? 1.9, we budgeted an LTP 1.6, so we have, I'm assuming, increased that to 1.9 for the plan. That's extra $300,000, 0.03%. I appreciate this table. How much, this is just curiosity's sake, so I've got, you know, that health cover, which costs me X amount personally, so I like claim back more than what it costs me so that it's worth it. And every time I order contacts, I make them pay me back for it. Go to the dentist, make them pay me back for it. I never go to the doctor, but if I went to the doctor, then I'll send those receipts in and get some money's worth. So this costs us the year on year, you know, like 1.2, 1.7, 1.9. What is the average claims that we put in against these insurance policies that we have, just to see a little bit of what the true cost is? Because this is just the premium cover, but we obviously are using our insurance.
It's an excellent question. I don't have the information in front of me as a part of the conclusion of this exercise. But as we go through and review the policies, we'll be looking at our claims history to make sure that as we're evaluating the type of cover that we have for the specific classes of assets, we'll have a look at our history and make sure we've got an informed decision we can make as to how we're covering those going forward. I do know that, you know, we do receive cover, like in the commercial motor, windscreens incidents, things like that, professional indemnity. We are utilising those policies. But as a part of the entire exercise, we'll go through the entire list of assets. Particularly, we've got 45,000 assets on our balance sheet, $2.7 billion worth of assets, making sure that we canvass the entire scenario and provide elected members with those options.
So, hey, thank you. I did have a question as well. This is one report I've scribbled all over. In fact, claims in these years, over claims, more bias the same question. I'd like to actually have that. I felt sort of lacking a bit of information. I know this is receiving the reports, not a decision one, but when it comes to decision, more information would be quite nice to see, you know, what our claims are. And it does appear to be what it is, not appear to be. It is quite a complex issue, and this paper sort of highlights that they go through the options. I appreciate that. But I do wonder whether you should be looking at some insurance professional gift to give advice. Don't hide them for the whole time, but you'd be wise in terms of the spend, because it is quite complex and there's a lot of things being done there. I noticed Wangarei has returned. It wasn't 100% sure how, probably, as it says here, by an excess of 500,000 or million. So, and then there are some things, for example, when you say, this is my last question, end of life, for example, shouldn't be replacement value, but indemnity value. If it's an asset, presumably we'll be depreciating it as well. And as it goes to end of life, we've recovered through the depreciation significant costs. So that should be part of that factor that comes into the consideration of that. So I agree with, yes, look at that. But it just shows you how complex it can be. So please look at the professional and then come back to something, because I'm sure we can make some savings. A 40% saving increase in 2023, 24 year of 22, 23. Now 9.5% since then. So I'm sure we can make savings. Thanks, Michael. And a bit like with me, I looked at it and thought, oh man, that's costly, but I realise you've got a lot of assets.
Any other comments? I've got a couple of notes that really it's the material damage business interruption and the PI cover, which are the big items. The rest of them are really relatively minor. And the PI cover and the excess layer there between those, that are $484,090,000. And that market, I've seen with other councils, is predominantly dealing with building consents, risks that the market is seeing, and those costs have gone up significantly. Some councils have experienced close to 300% increase between last year and this year, so it's a pretty big player in this.
300%?
Some of them have moved from around one council around 250 to about close to 800 to 900 area. So it's a difficult market in that area at the moment, and some of the providers are trying to put together better options at the moment out there that I'm aware of. The material damage business interruption, again, that's gone up by 130,000 or so. But we've got to look at the fact that we're including the Turner Centre, Papa Sports Hub, wastewater, water treatment plants, storage tanks, Kerikeri squash courts, public toilets, and heritage assets. So our coverage has gone up quite significantly. And generally in that area, the recent reviews that I have seen have been sort of a net reduction of about 2% on the prior year. So really that increases due to asset growth generally. So it's an area that is a major expense for the council. You know, that $2 million represents about 2% on rates. So it's something we should keep under close scrutiny. I've been encouraging management team to look at all the options, consider whether consultations needed with communities, with community facilities that may be getting towards the areas that John was talking about with the life, and should we be going for replacement or demolition, consulting with them what's the future of these if something happened. And that's going to take a bit of time because we need to consult carefully with the community. So I strongly support the moves that management is suggesting here to look at all the options and keep this under continuous review. As far as consultation and advice, we have retained a broking firm for that, and there's really only about two options in the market as brokers out there, but if we're not happy, we should also think about that. I'm not saying that is the case, but I'm putting that to management to think about, are we happy with the advice we've been getting? But effectively, there is only two players in the New Zealand market for councils. I'm aware of, one is Marsh and the other is Aon. and we're currently using one of those. So any other comments from any of the committee members? Just checking online, no. So I'm happy to, from the chair, to move the resolution that we receive the insurance renewal update. Do I have a seconder? John, thank you. Any final comments? All those in favour?
Aye.
Against, if any? No abstentions noted. Thank you, carried. Moving on to 5.3, the revenue recovery report on page 37. Come join us at the table, Zena. Charlie, I see you're the authorizer. Any opening comments from you?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just at a high level, I'll ask Zena to speak to the details. Council has acknowledged a trend where we are observing cost of living difficulties and the flow and impact into council's arrears balances, which are gradually increasing. We are taking active steps in terms of focusing our revenue recovery resources on assisting ratepayers in that situation. So proactively making calls to help people get onto payment plans, to avoid additional penalties, etc. It is something that we are keeping a close eye on, hoping with changes in the official cash rate and inflation expectations, etc., going forward, that we'll see a gradual reverse in those trends over time. But Zena's team has been instrumental in assisting in working through that and helping ratepayers of the district. So Zena, I'll leave with you to take us through the report.
Thank you. I'm Morena Koto. So just a few verbal updates, and before I get to those, I'll take that the report has been received and read. So first verbal update is, yes, revenue recovery have been doing pre-calling before we initiate the mortgage demand process, which is one option of recovery processes we have available to our team. Due to the timing of Christmas, we have now halted that pre-calling. Just because build up to Christmas, there is that additional pressure of expenses for our communities. So we have halted those pre-callings and will restart those in the new year. Just also to note that we have now initiated the mortgage demand process against two major financial institutes. And so from the date of that initial process that the customers and the mortgagee have been notified, we have 3 months to hold off, to encourage them also to set up a payment arrangement that meets our criteria that would halt that mortgage demand process. So after the 3 months of that initial notification, they won't be issued with the final demand. So moving forward, also to, we have been working really closely with the resource consents team. We have noticed that there has been a decrease of where we were based on last year to where we are now with that outstanding sundry debt with the resource consents team. We are continuing to work with them to try and reduce that even more. Legal have sent me a report that they had done previous years to look at withholding issuing the resource consent until we have received full payment. I've only just received that report, so it's something that I will look into and touch base with Trish Routley in the new year, if it's something that we could look at implementing, as we believe that other councils have been doing it as well, to help reduce that resource consent. for the Miromiro freehold land. So since the report has been submitted, we have now had an increase of reduction of our total arrears balance that had been written off for Whānau District Council. Previously, it was at $433,861. We have now increased that write-off debt to $596,862. We are still receiving requests for the CE write-offs. Currently, we have 123,000 that have been approved through our process, but they just need to be processed in our system as well. Moving on to the Whenua Māori Rating Relief Working Group. So in our report, we had advised that we had confirmed marae hui bookings. I can proudly say that we had held our first one on Saturday, the 23rd of November, at Waipuna Marae in Pangaru, to which we have received positive feedback from the community about us going to our community and actually letting them be heard instead of us talking to them, telling them this is what you need. We're giving them that opportunity to receive that firsthand knowledge of what relief or what options they have regarding their Whenua Māori. Our next one is scheduled for Monday the 16th of December at Otedia Marae. We are looking forward to our next one. We have confirmed tentative dates for Haitetai Marae Marae, which is in Whatuwhiwhi, for Friday the 14th of February. We are currently awaiting confirmation from Doma Marae for the tentative dates to ensure that it fits within our request from our elected members that they fit into our formal calendar as well for our meetings. Do I have any questions? Yes.
Good, thank you very much for this report. I've got a few questions. And then some observations. What is, so pre-calling is giving them a call to say, hey, you need to sort your stuff out, otherwise we're going to put a demand on your mortgage.
So through the chair, in regards to that, it's previously we haven't done the pre-calling. We've just gone straight to issue demand. So due to we understand what's going on in our communities, we've now implemented to start pre-calling those that have come up.
Other than just sending out another letter.
Yep, so we are making formal contact with the customers.
That's really great to know, because I would have thought that it would have been a given that we were doing, but great that we're doing it now. My other question was...
I'm conscious Kelly's had her hand up and she's got some time constraints. Just wondering, am I able to come back to you and allow Ko-Fi to raise her question?
Kia ora, Graham. Thank you. I hope you can hear me all right.
Very well.
Just on page 42, and Zena, you highlighted that resource consents, the debt outstanding is down significantly. What we're not seeing in this period is what has been wiped due to adjustments made, you know, because processing didn't occur within expected statutory timeframes. And we used to get a report at Regulatory and Compliance Committee. Maybe we need to have something to this committee outlining that those amounts that were wiped over the last 2 years.
Very good point that you raised. I see this pen scribbling notes here, so I think I take that it's been acknowledged, and we will see a note in the next revenue report. Thank you.
That's all I've got. Thanks.
Mayor, you had a second question.
I've got multiple. So we're not pre-calling. Does that mean we're just direct demanding, or we're just putting all that on hold until after Christmas?
for our next major financial institute, we are still dealing with, because we have issued mortgage demand for our second financial institute, we have noticed an increase in customers coming back to us. So these would be customers that we have pre-called to advise them with that possibility of recovery action on their account to set up a payment arrangement, or that have not come back to us or have not responded to returning our calls. So we have seen an increase in customers coming back to us now that we have issued that first process for mortgage demand. So we are focusing on that, and we will pick up the pre-calling again.
Thank you. My other question, or my other observation, was, and none of this is good because this is all there, this is all money that we need to run our district, but general vital rates arrears are actually more than Māori freehold land arrears. And that's something that I haven't noticed before, and I missed our last meeting, but I thought that was a observation on, and probably a testament to the work that's been ongoing. It's gone up so slightly. The number of accounts are down by 100 odd accounts, where for general, we have 2 million more than the year, a million and a bit more than the year ahead. My question is, debt recovery action to commence. What does that actually mean? That's a line item.
Yep. So
what does that actually mean?
So debt recovery action to commence is those that we have not started the mortgage demand process on, and also those that do not have a mortgage on their property.
So with that then, we've got like one, two, three, we've got 1,700, I'll use general as an example. We've got 1,799 accounts, which is significantly more than this time last year, which was 857 accounts. So I'm guessing that that's just goes to show that last year was a hard year for everyone. But still 857 debt recovery action to commence. I would expect that the large portion of that should always sit in the most recent calendar year. But if we go back across those calendar years, look at that, like 1.5 million in 22-23, 1 million in 21-20, 856,000 in 2019, 1.2 million in 2019 plus. Those are all still outstanding. They're still on hold to put a mortgage demand, and it's been 5 years. Why are we not selling their homes? Or why is the quantum so large across successive years that we haven't, it's still in the holding line item and not being moved across to one of those other ones that we need?
So I can speak to that. So with our recovery process, we currently have two options. One is if you have a mortgage on the property, that gives us another avenue to go down. But for those that don't have a mortgage on the property, our recovery options is we start the court proceedings recovery process, which could start with us applying for default judgment on the account, which then will go towards a charging order. Still with no payment after that, we then have the next step of issuing for financial applications. So that's when the courts order them to come in, and then they sit down and go through and realistically work out what they can afford to pay. So what happens with that is that if they can only afford to pay $5 a week and the court rule on that, we are locked in for them to pay $5 a week.
But then wouldn't they move from that line item of debt recovery action to commence to payment arrangements?
No, not that, because what happens is that we move the arrears from the rate account, which still sits there, to sit on a debtor account, so then that way it's not merging with the current rates as well, so they can make payment to clear the current without that debt still sitting on the account. It sits on a separate account, and as that judgment payments come through, then it gets written back onto the rate account at the end of each financial year to cover that credit that they have paid towards it.
Okay, then. So I shouldn't try and understand it all just with what, how we title this line item. but what it actually means.
Yes.
Because otherwise, when I study and look at it, I'm like, that looks like we are just still waiting to actually even do anything on 3.5 million this year general, 1.5 million the final, the previous year, 1,800,000, 1.2 total of $8.1 million. We actually haven't even done a solid poll for someone to actually action something, but that's incorrect of me to assume that.
Yes. What we could look at is...
Maybe we need to rename that line item from debt recovery action to commence to debt recovery action or something like that. To commence tells me that we haven't done anything as an organisation yet.
We can, in the appropriate forum, also include additional context or detail as to what's included in each bucket and the appropriate naming of those buckets.
Thank you, Mr. Chief.
Any other questions?
Yes, just one comment, quick question. Yeah, thanks, Zena. I know it's a difficult job you got there. And I like the free cooling, and I'd like to go further so that when you do everything, you approach people who that can be panicked if there's arrears and have genuine issues that are occurring, even outside of their own control. So developing actually go and talk to them or sit with them even face to face. And with the attitude of this, an acceptable way forward, I think this would help greatly. So renaming that, because you could be doing all of that prior to anything taken legally. The question I've got, though, is GST, on anything in the arrears that you write off, we probably really paid the GST. The paid the GST back in the book, I suppose that's directed to Charlie as well.
We handle the GST appropriately.
Any other questions? From my perspective, I was very pleased to see the increased work that's been done to make sure people are aware of all the rebates that are available to them. And that's not just the Murray Land areas, but also those that are on low income and various other rebates. And we need to reach out to make sure that we are taking the right ethical approach and considering the right cultural response to each of the groups that we've got, and so many of the people entitled to a rebate on rates will be also in the over 65 pension group that have some particular areas of reaching out. And so the work that we're doing to reach out, and other than the Murray freehold land scenarios.
In response to that, so when we are doing the whenua Māori marae hui, we are also taking the policies that would relate to general title as well, and also like the rates, rebate, application forms, everything that's considered relevant to rate, whether that's general title or Māori freehold land, we are still carrying that information on us while we are doing these hui as well, because not all the time, you know, there are other people that do have properties that are Māori freehold land, but then they also have general title as well. And we did notice that at the Waipuna Marae, there were a few queries about general title rates, and us having the staff on hand, we were able to answer their questions and also provide them with the applications that they needed as well. So it is our main target is whenua Māori to reduce that debt, but we are still open that there will be queries regarding general title as well.
So supplementary question to that is, when we're making phone calls, contacting these people is one of the standard items establishing whether they are getting all the rebates that they're entitled to as a starting point, so that we're being as helpful as we can before we move to having the discussion, well, we've got this outstanding now, we need to deal with what we are now agreed is outstanding.
So it is standard practice for the revenue recovery team to push the rates rebate application form as well. Considering at the moment the max that people can receive on the rates rebate application is $790, for this rating year. So we are bringing that to our customers' attention when they are making those phone calls as well.
With regard to prior rating years, are we able to retrospectively apply rates rebates or are we statute limited?
We are statute limited.
Yeah, so therefore it's probably very important that we're communicating each year with our rates demands going out to make sure people apply on a timely basis.
Yeah, and just in retrospect to that, so once someone has signed up for a rates rebate, so this year, in the next year, they automatically get sent a new application because they are already on the database.
Thank you for that clarification. Any other questions? Just checking online. If there are no other comments, I'll ask for a mover for the recommendation. Sorry, Charlie.
Happy to move. Oh.
That's all right. I'll note that, Kofi. I was just going to top up as well in terms of the other work that Council's doing in relation, not specifically for arrears balances, but for improving our customer service for online services. We're looking at how we review that to make the process of applying for making payments, setting up direct debits, applying payment plans, that's something which we are upon resolution on, and we're committed to improving the quality of service online for our digital ratepayers and revising the content of our invoices as well. So where we're able to point ratepayers in the direction of online information to better inform their decisions around how to apply for what rebates and things are available and how to apply for them, we're considering including information on our invoices for the ratepayers as they go through. So just okay. To add that in there as well. So we're taking a more holistic view in terms of.
Excellent. Thank you, Kofi Kelly, for moving that. Do we have a second? Oh, thank you very much. Any further discussion? Not on the motion. All those in favour?
Right.
Against, if any? No abstentions to be noted. Carried. Thank you, Lena, for that very informative report. Yeah, health and safety at 44 in the pack.
I'm just going to take the health and safety report. You could have straight out any further questions around the reports. Quarter just to email, please.
Any questions from members? Well, it's a very good report, Ian, from my point of view, and I'm pleased to see that we are doing taking steps to ensure our elected members who often inadvertently will end up into health and safety and possibly need to react on the fly. And the same with our other workers out there in the field doing and servicing our community. So very pleased to see that. Is there any questions from elected members? John?
Oh, I just want, I know it's threatening. So a lot of these you can work with, i.e. driving, heavy training or staff driving courses, so they can be more successful in some of the techniques. I've done some of those myself, and it's amazing what you didn't know. And I just noticed threatening behaviour is quite high, and that's probably hard to deal with. You want to comment on that? And that's just right. That's on page 45.
From elected members, probably.
Well, certainly,
we've had threatened behaviour. The reality is that I've sort of pulled out the people safe reporting going back the whole time we've reviewed people safe, which is a number of years now. You'll find that threat and behaviour reports have always been our highest reports due to the nature of work that council staff do.
Yeah. Question is, what are we doing to mitigate against that?
We have levels of
communication and controls for that risk, depending on level of risk associated with the activity we're doing. For example, animals probably up there in the highest risk for behaviour, so they are equipped with various pieces of PPE, including language devices, radios, bodyboard cameras, but they also then required to attend annual resolution training that is specifically designed for that level of conflict that they're expected to go through. So new starters will go through a two-day training course, and then existing staff will do a one-year refresher as an every year. And ironically, that's happening.
I think it's that conflict resolution that I wanted to hear, because you know, how you actually handle a situation when it's occurring in front of you is...
Yeah, so that's why we offer two types of conflict resolution training, depending on what your role is. If you offer front staff library, you get one type. Your client's role, animal management, monitoring, building compliance, to the real frontline people, then they get a much
escalated.
Thank you. Any other comments from members? I'd have to note that across the five councils, I'm involved in threatening behaviour as an increasing trend on all of them. You are not alone. Listen, I think it speaks, it's really arisen from during the COVID period onwards into an economic issue that people are under stress personally, and I think this flows through into their interactions with all sorts of members of the community, not just councils. So,
sorry, Graham.
It's a little endemic. Go fine.
Yeah, I just want to chime in. A lot of the mahi that I do as victim support volunteer is supporting people who have had, you know, been exposed to threatening behaviour, not violence or crime. It's, you know, people just abusing them verbally. And, like, it can take a lot of time for people to get over that. And so I just wanted to reiterate that, you know, whilst... some people might not think that it's a big deal to yell or, you know, call people names or, you know, just speak in, you know, real threatening manner. Many people are taken aback by it, and it's good that we have, we identify it as a risk and we have supports in place in our organisation.
Yeah, it comes from quite a few different areas, Kelly. But I mean, example, recently, the front door of Kaikohe Library got smashed in during the middle of the night. You know, then the library staff arrived on a Saturday morning, and that's what they arrived to work to find. There was no one there giving them direct threatening behaviour, but nevertheless, that's a violent incident that they walked in upon, you know, and
yep.
They were dealing with that.
So,
offering a level of support around that is important.
Agreed.
Thank you for those comments. Any other points to raise? Rofa, are you happy to move?
Yep, I can move that.
Thank you. John, you're second?
Yep.
Thank you. Any other comments before I place the motion? All those in favour?
Right.
Against, if any? No abstentions to be noted? Thank you. Carried. We're now moving on to our people and capability report. I'm not sure whether it'll be Kerry or is it you, Emma, that will be speaking for this one.
Chair, Maureen Nakoto. This is our quarterly report 41. So just to acknowledge there is a typo on the first page of the report. 41, July to September of our new financial year. I'll take the report as read, but there are three things I just wanted to highlight. In terms of our turnover for this quarter, it's much lower than quarter one of the previous financial year, which will be indicative of the employment market as a whole, but also reflective of some of the work that we've done in terms of our culture and the stability we've been providing over the last 12 months. The second point I wanted to highlight is in our infrastructure services group, we've had a concerted effort around recruitment to the point where today there are only 5 positions that haven't been filled, which has taken a great deal of work on behalf of Tanga, but also the people in capability there. So I just wanted to acknowledge the mahi that's gone on there. And the third point, I just wanted to thank Mia Moko for putting us in touch with Zeal Recruitment. So we're working with Zeal Recruitment, which is like an app-based job.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Yes, right.
You're right. thank you, Mia Moko, for putting us in touch with them. So we've been using Zeal Recruitment and advertising some of our roles with them. That's everything that I wanted to highlight. If you have any questions or comments.
Questions from members?
I have a question.
Yes, you.
Sorry. It's not really related to this, but did you say there are 5 unfilled vacancies?
Not everyone has commenced, has started their employment yet, so some are starting in the new year, but we have...
My brain's pinging off there that we are down on our budget lines are down for the next report on staffing to the tune of 1.2 mil. But 1.2 million divided by 5 vacancies equals 240k for each of those staff members. I think I'm going to quit as mayor and run for one of these jobs. Or am I reading it wrong?
My take on that, and correct me if I'm wrong, is the numbers are showing that we had more vacancies earlier in the year and that we're now, and that's why we've got to
catch up. They don't align the times between the financial reporting and this one.
Okay. Kofi.
Thank you. Couple things. I've go to page 51st, where there is, you know, 1 or 2 comments about would you recommend FNDC as an employer of choice? And there's a no. How would you rate the overall management at FNDC? 2 people say there's room for improvement. One person disagreed that they had they didn't have the resources needed to do their job. So sorry, somebody just walked in. So I just wanted to highlight that, and the fact that there's, you know, I can't see much narrative around that, or, you know, if you could give me some comfort, Emma, that SLT do have a look at the comments, and Guy perhaps considers what's being said, and, you know, any feedback is good feedback, even if it's negative. But I have one more comment if staff want to respond to that. I'll just mute myself because there's a bit of noise here.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. The exit surveys that are completed, it's up to those individuals about how much information they choose to tell us or not. They also select whether that information can be shared with their people leader, their general manager, with PNC, the chief executive. So when they indicate they're happy for their comments to be shared, they get shared with all of those relevant people. So it depends on who they want to see that information as to who we share that with. But the comments are certainly reviewed and taken seriously. As you say, kind of any feedback is good feedback, because at the end of the day, we want to make improvements. So we are considering the feedback that comes through in the exit interviews.
Thanks. And on page 51, there were comments about, where is it? Flexible remote working and the feedback, you know, reinforcing the importance of having this as a benefit for staff. However, our council had signalled a very strong desire to have staff working back in the offices together, being more available, you know, to one another and managers, even to elected members. How is the organisation implementing that strong, you know, vision from the governing council?
Through the chair, there are a number of things that we have put in place to encourage in-work attendance. So the first is we have set an expectation for staff to be in the office 3 days a week. We have also updated our letters of offer for all new staff members to clarify what hybrid working looks like. With the majority of that time to be spent working in an FNDC office. We have been working through our people leaders and setting expectations for all staff about spending more time in the office than perhaps has been done before. So there are a number of things we've got to play to meet the expectations around in office attendance, which ultimately all boils down to working better together so we can deliver better services for our communities.
Yeah, kia ora, Emma. Total all that. I don't want to take away the, you know, good recognition that the team had a couple of years ago for, you know, what was it called? I forget what that... Yeah, that's it. Yeah. And also, I do recognise that there is value in having the ability for staff to work from home. You know, things do come up, and it's been very helpful. And I know that many staff are productive. But I just, you know, do want to highlight that what myself, you know, as chair of ERC, am hearing time and time again is, you know, how do we know that staff are being productive at home? So there is that as well. So perhaps in future we can see some, you know, that these are the values of why we still have this, but this is how we know that it is, you know, enabling productivity as well. Just, I don't know how you would measure that, but yeah, thank you. That's me.
Minatoe, have you got a question?
No, sorry, I don't have a question at all. I'm here.
I have a question to what our deputy mayor just raised. At school, when the kids have to do these new NCA exam things internally or the external exams, they all use computers now. There's software so that they can't cheat. Now, I'm pretty sure that government departments use this for hybrid models, where you have to like log in, and then if you don't touch your computer in X amount of time, then it will clock you out. Have we investigated stuff like that? Like for, so that, you know, someone's like, I know that for, like for your guys' department, well, you don't do your work on a computer, but if you're out chasing someone's dog, inspecting someone's building, and not in an office where someone can see you and tell you to stop playing on Facebook or YouTube. But have we investigated any of the smart solutions to tracking productivity? I'm in motion study.
Through the chair, I can address that.
Oh, not on my one.
This is a topic that's been discussed actually at CE's forum in Northland. It's a sensitive issue because of privacy, some privacy issues, I think, around monitoring programs for with staff. So we haven't specifically looked at detailed ideas around that as yet. It always remains a possibility. more generally, this return to work and the hybrid working model is becoming, I think, a very major issue right across the country. In fact, probably globally, it would be a fair comment.
I think Minister of Finance and Public Service, or whatever it is, wasn't she on the front page saying all government members get your bodies back into work?
That's right. So central government has given guidance on this one. We have not issued a dictate in terms of everybody will be back at work for 3 or 5 days. We don't want to do that. What we're trying to do here is, there's a purpose for having people back at work. And I see it as the pendulum just swung too far in one direction, which is working from home. The hybrid model was introduced in 2019-20 summer for the drought. And then obviously we, right on the heels of that, we had lockdowns of COVID. Well, that's now nearly 5 years ago. And I think we've just got an established pattern of people working at home. And I think the cost of that has been to our workplace culture and to collaboration amongst staff and between teams in particular. And to be fair, it's been indicated by our staff and all the team meetings that I had that they would like to see more collaboration and more interactions between teams. So we just, in terms of our efforts to drive continuous improvement, we are encouraging people to get back to work. We're trying to make some sense of that in terms of can we apply performance metrics to the different businesses and measure effectively what happens when staff are back at work versus working remotely. We also want to try and have some measures around collaboration and productivity. And there are various tools we can use to look at that, which we're investigating. Generally, we need people to be back at work more, and that's been communicated, and looking towards that.
Follow-up question. Objective. Have we removed from all of our Tinder for jobs, if we want people back in work, have we removed hybrid working as one of the come and work for us because you can work from home? And are we making sure that it's not a part of employment contracts then, which then locks us into something that we are actively trying to dilute?
I guess just as our chief of staff just mentioned, we've changed the clause in the hybrid working so that it just makes it clear that the employee.
Do we have metrics around how many people are working from home on Mondays or Fridays? Yes. So I know for us, it actually comes down to if we told everyone, mandated everyone to come back and work in the office, we actually don't have enough desks and seats for our 400 staff to work from the office. So we actually can't do it. But how many, what data metrics do we have around the occupancy levels of all of our actual desks that we have across our entire organisation so that it could be phased so that we actually do have deaf people working hybridly at times. But what data do we have to back that sort of stuff up or to investigate that further?
Do you want to speak to that, Evan?
Through the chair, we are collecting that data right now, Amir. Yeah.
I know that for Kirikiri office, for example, when we got we were investigating coming back to work, our occupancy across those hot 100 hot desks was only 20%. And then once we said that, it bumped right up to 80% because it's like use it or lose it, which is really great. So I just wondered what the metrics are for across our entire organisation and all of the actual desks and seats we have across our offices.
So that's a couple of points. The occupancy in JVC is far higher than Kaikoi. Very clear to see that. In terms of Mondays and Fridays,
when you put a barbie on, I think everyone comes in.
Correct. There's a better turnout, but generally, there's less people in the office on Mondays and Fridays, which is not the right optic.
No, it's not. And because I come in on a Friday and walk around, and it's a ghost town, which makes me have concerns as the mayor that are shared by the general public of Whānau.
So we are certainly pushing the rationale for people to come back to work as being around collaboration and productivity. It's also important for us to find what is the right balance for the good of this institution and for the culture of the workforce. It's also going to inform us as to our future needs for office space. We right now would appear we have too many desks, but that should change. If we want to plan for the future, then we need to a period of time where we can measure the occupancy and then plan for the future.
John, you had the next question.
Yeah, I did have some notes here. I have been highlighted the location and those that half said the least, they like the least, and half said they like the most. And I was wondering which half was working from home, if it was a half or not. But yeah, just comments like that aside. The area that reflects a good organisation, as you probably know if you read my latest article, is the culture of the organisation, and that's the one that has the lowest, if you want to look at that, performance in some respects, because there's about, what is it, a neutral in terms of whether the culture is working or not. So the question is, and I know, Guy, you did sort of answer that, but what are the efforts it may relate to? Again, if you're working from home, it's very hard to get a good culture working and get the synergies that come from that. I've worked in both environments and I know how difficult it is. And one of the things that we've done, and I mentioned this before as well, is the for me, it was very much a performance orientated approach. So there was a delivery that was pretty granular that had to be recorded. In fact, in probably 15-minute intervals. Now, that was the norm that others were doing as well. So it took care of a lot of the issues that have been talked about. And you knew what project you're working on, so you could just see the performance against the project. Now, do we implement that as a question for you, that you've got? Because that will actually show what's happening in that area. But I'm really more interested in the culture of the organisation, because rather than using a big stick approach, having a good culture, generally people get enthusiastic and then they pick up the reins, so to speak, because it gives them positive feedback in terms of their, what's actually happening. So it's just really a question on how we're going addressing our culture in terms of continuous improvement.
Just some general comments there.
I was just noting, and maybe Ngitoe's got a question, and maybe you'll be able to wrap up.
Okay.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, kia ora, Mr. Chair. Thank you. Look, I just wanted to, just through the chair to the CEO, I just wanted to know, in order to get everybody back at work, I hear Moko said we need roughly 400 chairs, or 400 desks. So does anybody there amongst the group actually know how many available chairs we do have?
Yeah, we have a total number of desks, which... top of my head, I couldn't tell you what that is.
Okay. Okay. All right. So that's the first thing we need to find out, Mr. CEO. We need to know how many seats do we have, and then the next thing we need to do is find out how many additional seats we need, and what additional office space we need to acquire to ensure that the people need to come back. I don't have a lot of faith right now, Mr. CEO, that our staff, or your staff, are addressing this issue, because the fact that I asked that question, no one in the room knows how many seats we have, it means that no one wants to find out. So this is what I'm thinking. I want the staff to find out today and tomorrow exactly how many seats there are, because this has been going on for a long time now. And, I'm a kind of person that tends to get really frustrated when things aren't getting done, right? And if they're not going to get done, then I'm likely to lodge a motion next meeting, and we'll just force everyone back to work. And that'll mean that all the staff will have to find out how many seats we have, how many additional seats we have, and what are the available office spaces in Kaikohe and Kerikeri that we can lease so that we can get everyone back. Because this is not good enough. It's been going on a year. We've been in here almost 2 years now, and this has been a recurring theme. And I want it to be bought. It's really a perennial bugbear for me, and I want it to be dealt with very swiftly, And if I don't feel like it's going to be done, then I can promise you all now, I will put a forward motion and garner the numbers from my elected members, the friends that I have in council, and then we'll force it on the staff to do that. Kia ora.
Did you want to respond to the question?
Okay,
the last two and three.
Okay. Those comments. General comments are we're not the only institution facing this issue. Interestingly, I had a conversation with a senior person at the PSA last week to wrap up our annual negotiation round on pay reviews. And we started the discussion on this topic. The PSA are having similar issues and not sure how to approach it in terms of getting their staff back to work. They're also hesitant to issue a demand just across the board to have everyone in the office full time. So that probably doesn't help you, but that...
No, that's not really helpful at all, Guy. Yeah, I don't accept that as an answer. It's not an attack on you, but because you haven't been here the entirety of the time that I've been here, but I do want this issue to be resolved. And yeah, people might like the idea of working for home. Kapai, I accept that there needs to be a balance. But this organisation is ratepayer money, and I want us to ensure to be able to provide the public with the insurance that our people are at work. They're not fart-assing around at home. They're not driving around. They're not parked up at Arawa Beach. They're not at the Hohora Pacific Tavern having a few beers at 1:30 in the afternoon, or they're not at the Awanui pub having beers. Okay, I don't want to be a whistleblower, but I'm quite frank, I'm not really interested in other organisations. I'm interested in this organisation and how we move out of pedestrian-like, where we have people at home doing whatever they do, and I want us to move into an environment where we're firing on all cylinders. We don't have a massive underspend, and people are doing the jobs that they're paid to do, and if they don't like it, well, they can find another job. And I say that, and I understand the environment's hard, but it's hard for everyone. But everybody needs to start pulling finger, and we got to do better. We got to improve. Always, we must improve. So it's not a criticism of yourself; it's a criticism of myself also, and the other elected members that we haven't dealt with this issue. But I just want it to be dealt with. So please, can we find out how many seats we have? If there's two or three, 250, 260 suite, then let's start filling those seats and let's start. Looking for other space so that we can put other desks and other seats in there. I mean, it's not really hard. We've got the money, we've got the budget to do it. It's just a matter of doing it. And people won't like it because they don't like change. But, you know, everyone's got to start pulling their weight. Kia ora.
Okay, thank you for those. Thank you for those comments.
You there, Mr. Chairman?
Councillor Radich.
Yeah, I'm just listening to Pinatar. Look, it doesn't matter if they work at home or at council. All the ratepayers want is getting things done. That's all they want. You know, and in my many years on council, we are achieving those roles. This idea of getting mates and getting votes in to change things around, that's a joke. You know, it's getting things done. That's all the ratepayers want. It doesn't matter if their staff are working at home or in council. Simple. Thank you.
Thank you. Pinatawi, is your hand up for a further question or is it residual? Thank you. I guess I noted on page 49 the key reasons for leaving: family commitment, relocating, career opportunity, and all those seem to be quite logical, and especially in a situation where people may need to relocate because of changes in jobs, redundancies, etc., and thinking about it. What I would be interested in, and a measure that I saw in a commercial organisation I was involved with, is an analysis as to regretted departures and non-regretted departures. And just wondering whether we give some thought about giving analysis, because those that we really are sad to see go versus the ones that, shall we say, we're not so sad to see depart, it can be actually quite insightful also. Yeah, because often one of the biggest frustrations of staff and performance management is if they see management not addressing underperformance, and therefore they feel that they're having to carry underperformers. And that can have quite a negative impact on the culture of the organisation. So have a think about that. It may not be possible, and it might end up raising more questions in a public entity than we wish to, you know, see and cause questions that touch into privacy issues. So have a think about that, whether it's feasible or not, and the merits of it. Yeah, but I think overall, I think we've got to be pretty pleased with the changes that we're seeing over the 18 months I've been here and looking at reports. This is one of the more positive ones that I've certainly seen from this area. We have a resolution on the table there. It's on page 48, I think, my notes. Is that right? Of safety, no, that's the wrong one. It's page 47. There, have I got someone that will move that? Pinatoa, are you happy to move that direction?
It's gone.
I'll move.
You'll move, John. Do I have a seconder? And I should also note that Anne, Mia, thank you for that. Anne, you've joined us. Welcome. Thank you. Finish your chairing duties. Thank you for that. Is there any more discussion? It's been moved and seconded. I'll put the resolution. All those in favour? Against, if any? No abstentions have been noted. Carried. 5.6, Council Financial Report. Angie and Charlie.
Thank you. Morena koutou. So for this financial report, this is as at the 31st of October 2024. Just the general statement. You will see the variances in the financials quite going up and down. Due to, it's usually like this in the first round while we're meeting with departments to phase their budgets accordingly to their work programs. So timing is usually one of the main variants. So the year-to-date income, we are ahead of by a budget by 10 million. Again, timing is mainly the cause for this, but this is mainly due to the subsidies we receive, mainly in road ink. Also, with the operational expenses, we are slightly behind budget by 2.9, mainly in personnel in terms of the staff vacancies, contractor fees, and external services. Apologies. Moving on to the capital expenditure, again, we are tracking ahead of budget by 17.9 million. We've got a number of projects on the go at the moment, particularly in roading, which is driving this. So, especially with the now that we're in the summer period, so we have got in terms of on page 65. We've got a number of unbudgeted amounts that's sitting there with, which is quite significant. This is mainly due to all the emergency works that hadn't occurred, which has moved into this financial year. But there is a lot of progress happening in this space at the moment. In terms of Treasury, we are sitting strong in terms of our cash compared to last year. We're sitting at 38.6 mil. So happy to take any questions.
Mayor.
Cool. I have one, two, three questions. And it's probably not so much for you, Angie, but for GMs. And it may be that, I know this is the first one, so by the end of it, it'll be sweet. But it might be just the wording in our reports. So page 61, community and engagement are over budget, $245,000 due to annual levy payments, civil defence and emergency management.
Mm.
So to me, like, over budget, but an annual levy, how is an annual levy over budget when it should be captured? And if something's annual and then you plan for it, you rate for it, and then you pass it on, how is it then over budget?
GM Comms and Engagement is going to answer that one. Ruben.
Certainly happy to. Yep, happy to answer that, Mayor Mokko. This budget item has in the past fit with corporate services budget lineup, and only this year has that been migrated over to the comms and engagement group for budget. And that's why it's showing as a over budget, because it hasn't been traditionally reported under comms and engagement. Community and engagement, rather, and seeing that I've managed the civil defense function, that budget has just been recently migrated over. And just double checking with Charlie and finance, we've just I'm aware that that levy is associated to the contribution that council elected in 2022 of December of 2022 towards the new civil defense facility that they're building in Whangarei.
I'll need to verify.
So then I'd expect to see a corresponding corporate services is $245,000 under budget.
I'm not reading that.
But those little statements would even have saved my question if it wasn't added to the commentary here. My other one was on page 62. Now, for external services, district facilities are under budget by $308,000 for reactive maintenance for housing for the elderly. I have been getting numerous requests for service from pensioners, and a specific one from one of our uncles up at the Kaipuhi village here, and I think he drives his mobility scooter down to council here every day to see if I'm in, so that he can follow this up with me. We've formally, through our RFS system, have been just going back to him to say council did not budget this because we're looking to divest. So there's no budget to do the work. And the work required is, if you go up there, and actually some of us actually did a little tiki-tool up there, and there's a gap between our footpath and the grass, which is about that much. And then we also went on our footpath, and when we installed aircon units on our pensioner houses, we put the aircon unit not up on above, at like above your head, so to keep the little 900 mil width footpath free, we put it on the footpath, so now the footpath itself is only, you know, like, I don't know, 400 mil, so he can't drive his mobility scooter along the footpath, park it up. We also didn't put ramps in, so that was a big item. That means that he has to drive his mobility scooter from where he charged it to access his home by using the rail on his steps down a gap between our footpath outside his home and the grass that is that thick. I managed to get my uncle, who just happened to be a lollipop man that day we were visiting, to build him up a little ramp using some of the gravel from across the road on a different project. But it needs to be done properly because it's safety, health and safety issue here. And actually, he already has had an accident. So Fire Donna, our EA to the mayor, has told me from when he came down to visit. So when I'm getting the story from an organisation consistently that there's no budget lines for health and safety elements at our Kaikuke village,
or someone vulnerable who is a pensioner, and then I read in this paper that we're $308,000 under budget for reactive maintenance, the maths is not mathsing for me to understand what's going on here. So can someone answer my question on that one, please?
Charlie, you've indicated you might have a response.
Through the chair, thank you, Miromiro. Appreciate the concern. Apologise, this particular bullet point has been poorly worded. The 308 is in reference to the overall expenditure, where the housing for the elderly component is 64,000. That, but we do duly note.
Oh, even 64,000. It's going to cost a couple hundred dollars to build him a concrete ramp. I'll do it myself. Maybe I'll just do it myself. I did it myself, temp one, that's not working. But do you see what I mean? Like, someone fix this.
I've made a note to follow up with our district facilities team just in relation to that item. We are cognizant that we're now moving with some speed in relation to the housing for the elderly divestment project. And we have had a steer in general that any existing budget is for health and safety considerations, but to not go beyond that. If there has been a decision made not to, or an awareness of this particular issue, that we do have budget to remediate, then we'll address it. Thank you for that feedback.
Thank you. And my final one is just page 64, and it may be nothing, but and this is your one too, please, Charlie. And that is corporate services are over budget, $437,000 due to renewal vehicles. Now, we'll recall last year's audit, or was it year before that audit, where pool vehicles were one of those pingers. And I just wanted some background because we budget for pool vehicles. At last annual plan, we were significantly over budget on, it was unbudgeted expense or whatever it is for pool vehicles. So I thought at that point we had captured the fact that we needed to ensure we budgeted accordingly for our pool vehicles. But I'm seeing in here that we over budget again, and it's just, I just need some, what's that thing that you guys always say? Governance comfort around that this isn't then going to be in our next auditor's report. It's something else that we haven't managed to sort out from the last.
Through the chair, thank you, Mayor Mokal. I believe this is in relation to time. When the expenditure comes through. So we have an annual budget which is spread evenly throughout the year. And if we've front-footed some of that capital expenditure, you'll see that as a variance reducing over time. That is my understanding. However, I will look into it and provide additional detail to make sure that's correct.
And those are my questions. Thank you.
Any other comments from members? I have raised earlier the table on pages 65 through 67, and we take the first line in unbudgeted roading, actually needs to be read in conjunction with the last line on page 67 as an example. I've asked them perhaps to do the offset so we can get the net effect, so it's easier to see everything. So they've assured me that for future reports, we'll look into whether they can achieve that because of better. The picture there. One of the common themes coming up seems to be timing and phasing of our budget. So we've certainly looked at, we've done a lot of work in the accounting team to sort out all the reconciliations and the hygiene factors for the annual report. We've got a project I mentioned earlier on consolidation. And just wondering whether following that it could be appropriate for looking at how could we look at how to get the timing and phasing in our budgets, and perhaps in the reports indicate that we're over budget, but this is a timing issue and expected to be resolved by year end. Might provide members with a little more information as we go forward until we can get perhaps a project looking at the phasing going forward. Angie, you might.
Yeah, so comment. What we normally do in the beginning, before we start rolling into the new year, we do spend time with the teams to phase accordingly to the peaks and how we see them coming, seasonality and all the rest of it. But there's sometimes unexpected items that come up. But we are working with them now that we're starting to settle with our teams into the new year.
And you might find better tools when you move to the cloud version of Tech One also, because you are dealing with a very much a legacy product. So see what it's about and just have a think about that for future budget rounds. It's not going to be a quick solution, and you've got a lot on your plate. You've had Annus Horribilis with an LTP. You've then had annual plan, had annual audit, et cetera, et cetera. So I do recognise the pressures that have been in there in your team, and it's been really good to see the progress that's been made since I've been on deck. Not saying that's me that's achieved it, it's all you, but in my time frame that I've had a close involvement. Councillor.
Yeah, thank you. Just one general comment, and thanks, Mayor, for those comments. It appears to me and that we're still suffering this legacy of not actually having the good asset management and therefore the project management which can go with it. Because a lot of these issues, I think, can be solved by looking at that. So the question is, how are we are progressing with management system, aren't we? Good. Yes, then I won't make any other comments because I can just see that this will solve a lot of these issues. And we discussed the table. I think we mentioned that before, prior to the pre-meeting. I'd love to see that so that we can get a net effect, because from a maybe from us councillors' point of view, we can see it. But certainly the first line to the last line is a big difference in how you correlate them. So let's do it out there so the public can actually appreciate and understand it. So thanks, Graham, for that idea.
Yeah, for a neat difference line. So, you know, I sat down and got the calculator out, and it could easily be achieved, I suspect.
Yeah.
I'll leave that forward with you. There's no other questions.
You there, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, certainly, Councillor.
I'll just go back to page 59, 149,000. This is on income from reimbursement of power bills from the Te Hiko Sports Hub. Was this done prior to the opening of the complex? Guy, was it?
Sorry, could you repeat that question, please?
This one here, he's referring to 149K for reimbursement of power bills.
From the Te Hiko Sports Hub. Was this done prior to the opening of the complex?
I don't know.
Why I ask that is because I've just been told recently that the complex is at this very moment in financial problems.
We can investigate that. I don't know the answer.
So was this 149,000 reimbursement done prior to the opening? No one knows that.
I see Charlie's making some notes, Councillor.
Right.
Can he or Angie come back to you offline?
Yeah. Yep, no worries.
If you can note that, please, guys. Okay, so, do I have someone to move the recommendation on page 55? Thank you, John. Second. I'll second it from the chair. Any further discussion on that? If not, all those in favour?
Aye.
Against, if any? No abstentions noted. Carried. It's now time to move into excluded. Page 76 and 77 of our papers have all the reasons and the matters to be considered during public excluded. Do I have a mover to take us to public school? Thank you, John. Okay, you're happy to second that? Thank you. All those in favour?
Right.
Against, if any? No abstentions noted. Carried. Thank you. We're now in public excluded.